Hi, this is Vicki. I promised a tutorial on marking and sewing buttons by machine for the surgical cap for frontline workers, Winnipeg 2020. So a couple of things, a couple of different ways of marking them, and then a couple of different ways of sewing them. This is the pattern for the hat band. It has marks for button placement. I put them on both sides, but you really only are going to need the one. However, you have to mark both sides of the fabric. I don't have an actual band cut here, but I've got a piece of fabric. So I just poked a hole in my pattern using my sewing awl. Any sharp object will do. Make the hole big enough for a pen to go through. So when the pattern piece is still lined up on the cut fabric, your fold line for cutting is up here, and then you just mark that through. But then you would also need to flip the fabric over, flip the pattern over. Now you can see my pattern has cardboard on the back, and mark for the other side as well. I cut multiple layers of fabric at a time, so I find that to be just very tedious and kind of an extra step. So I've worked out a way of doing that by marking the caps after they're sewn. So I measured from that fold line, the center front is 6.5 inches down. And then from the lengthwise fold line, which becomes the finished edge of the cap next to the wearer's face, is 1.5 inches. If you would prefer to work, measure from the back edge of the cap where the strap is, that seam is, that's been sewn, so it's got a seam allowance removed from it, so I've marked where that seam allowance is, and to the button placement from the seam is 5 inches up, and it's still 1.5 inches from the lengthwise fold or the finished face edge of the cap. So whichever one you want to do, use those measurements. Cut just a piece of cardboard to those dimensions. So I've cut one 6.5 by 1.5. Then I have clipped a bit off of one corner, put my arrow there, and that's where my button placement is going to be. And then I can use that to mark on the finished cap. So I'll take my finished cap, line up the back edges, line up those finished front edges, and then the fold that forms at the top is going to be center front. I'll line up my cardboard template with that center front and with the finished folded edge, and then I will make a mark where that snipped corner is. If you're working from the back edge, you would have a 5-inch piece and you would line it up with the seamed edge. Same thing. Choose one and stick with that. I have dark fabric, so I've used a white marking pencil that's made for the sewing industry, but a white or a yellow light colored pencil crayon will work just fine. If you ever wondered what those white pencil crayons were for, now you know. If you have light colored fabric like this, then you can use any dark pen, a pencil, a Sharpie, it doesn't matter, because that mark is going to get covered up by the button. Okay, now to sew it, you're going to need some kind of zigzag foot because the needle is going back and forth through the two holes of the button. Right now, I have my regular zigzag foot installed on the machine, and that will work. I would put the cap under first, line up my mark that I made underneath the slot in the foot where the needle goes, and then slide the button under there. Put the foot down, and then I have to try and see. Like I said, this is possible, it's not easy, especially with this four-hole button, it wants to slide out. And it's hard to see. And I would definitely want to hand wheel this at least to start with. If that's the only foot you have, you can make it work. It's going to take a little longer. Another thing you can do to help keep the button from sliding around once it's under there, this is some medical bandaging tape that I happen to have. It's got texture that'll grip the button. Put that on the underside of your foot, under here. and then you'd have to cut out for that slot. You could also use double-sided tape if you have some, like scrapbooking tape. But there are other feet you can use. This is an open-toed foot. It's a little hard to see because it's clear, but it's open in the front, makes it much easier to see where the button is. So I'll put that one on. And same thing, you might need to put some tape underneath to help it grip, but it's only gonna be at the back because you want to keep that open. So again, line that mark up, line that button up, put the foot down. I'm starting with the front holes of the button. And then I have to make sure that my zigzag width and the length is set properly. My machine has a setting for buttons. It looks like a circle with a dash through it. When I engage that, it shows that my width setting is 3.5 millimeters. My length setting is 0. You've got to have the length at 0. You don't want the machine to try and move anything forward or backward through the machine. Just, you want the needle to go back and forth. So on a machine where you set the width with a dial, that's going to be between 3 and 4. So set it somewhere there between 3 and 4, and then turn your hand wheel to make sure that the needle is going through the holes of the button and doesn't hit the button. A note about buttons, most buttons, and I emphasize most, you want to always check this with your hand wheel, the holes are spaced the same width apart on almost all buttons. Some of them are, I can see that one's a little different, but always check with the hand wheel before you start sewing with the power on your machine. So this one is set at 3.5 millimeters. I've got it under the foot, so I'm still going to turn the machine by hand a couple of stitches. That does two things. It tells me that the needle is going through the holes of the button. It also anchors the button to the fabric, and it's less likely, it's very unlikely that it's going to move. So then I can use the foot pedal on my machine, let the machine do the sewing. And my machine, butting setting, it takes a certain number of stitches, and then it stitches in one hole to tie off. I don't think that's enough stitches, so I run that cycle twice. In theory, it makes a knot underneath there, but I'm still going to tie it and to show you. So I make sure my needle's up, I lift my foot, I can pull it out and clip the thread so that I have enough length to tie. And then to get the thread that ended up on top, the needle thread through, I'm going to pull on that bobbin thread, and then I can use just about any pointed object. That one is not pointed enough. A pin, my seam ripper. When I give that thread a tug, it pulls up the loop. It should pull up the loop. Okay, I think I put too many knots in there. Anyways, it should pull through, and then you can tie those threads together a couple of times and finish that off. Another thing you can do, if you have this stuff, fray check or fray stop, it's basically diluted crazy glue. You dab that on the knot or on the entire bundle of threads that's on the back of the button, and that secures that a little bit more. Then those threads are safe to clip. If you have a machine that comes with a button foot, there are a couple of styles. I don't have both of them. One of them is a foot much like this, but the toes are shorter and they have little rubber socks on the end to help grip the button. There is a video on the Facebook page for the surgical caps for frontline workers that Bev Rapinda did, showing that foot, and that works great too.